Good afternoon. On behalf of my co-authors, I thank the organizers for the opportunity to participate in this session. We send our regrets from the United States, New Zealand, and Greenland that we're unable to be with you in person. Our research focuses on investigating the physical characteristics of tattoos created using different tools and techniques, and applying those findings to examinations of tattoos preserved on mummified human remains. Our initial study was published in the EXARC Journal this past September. Today, we will discuss that study, provide additional results, and apply our findings to examinations of preserved tattoos on the skin of mummies from Europe, Siberia, and South America. Please note that this presentation includes detailed images and video of tattooing, as well as images of archaeological human remains. Cultures throughout the past and across the globe practiced tattooing, as evidenced by tattoos preserved on hundreds of deliberately and naturally mummified human remains. These individuals originate from at least 50 archaeological sites across 5 continents, and the oldest, from Central Europe and Egypt, are dated to approximately 3200 BCE. Some of these preserved tattoos were exhibited in museums and illustrated in publications as early as the 19th century, while others have been described in modern academic studies. Many other examples are located in institutional collections and have yet to be cataloged or documented in a meaningful way. For those interested in learning more about these finds, there is an open source, periodically updated database of tattooed mummies that you can access via this bitlink. As the practice of tattooing grew in popularity over the early 21st century, there has been a related increase in efforts to incorporate permanent body marking into descriptions, representations, and interpretations of ancient cultures. Unfortunately, despite these efforts, many aspects of ancient tattooing, including the toolkit and methods of application, remain largely unknown. Our goal with this project was to test if there were identifiable differences in tattoos created using different tools and methods of application, and to create a preliminary database of direct physical data that could be compared with preserved archaeological examples. The study began in 2021, born out of Instagram chats between our 3 authors who live on opposite corners of the globe and have still yet to meet each other face to face. We were supported in our efforts by a generous grant from John Kiernan and an EXARC Experimental Archaeology Award. There was no single tool or technique used to tattoo among societies of the past. Instead, tattooing technologies and methods varied by region, culture, and era. To account for these variations, we designed a study in which we recreated and tested 7 separate pre-electric tattooing tool types. We also included a modern 7RL tattooing needle as a comparative data point. Here you see a summary of the tools and techniques used in our study. The materials for all these tools were ethically and sustainably sourced in Tennessee and Aotearoa and crafted by hand by the authors. In July 2021, team member Danny Riday, who's a professional tattooist from Aotearoa, underwent nearly 12 hours of tattooing, marking his own leg with 8 identical patterns. Danny designed this pattern in order to allow for the direct comparison of intersecting lines and filled areas, as well as a comparison between homemade ink, which is used to fill the upper triangles in each design, and modern commercial tattoo pigment, which is used for the lower triangles. Even at first glance, there are observable and somewhat visceral differences in the tattooing process. For example, here we see subdermal tattooing, in which a bird bone needle pulls pigment-infused thread beneath the skin of Danny's leg. This technique was used historically in the circumpolar regions and parts of South America. The subdermal tattooing you just saw is a much different process than hand tapping, where in this case, a bone point is hafted at an angle to a wooden handle and struck with a mallet to drive it into the skin. It's sometimes assumed that the hand tapping method represents all ancient tattooing. However, historically, it was limited to Oceania, island Southeast Asia, and pockets of inland Southeast Asia and the Indian subcontinent. Hand tapping is in turn different than hand poke tattooing using a single point bone awl, or then tattooing by incision, where an obsidian flake is used to shallowly slice the skin before pigment is rubbed in from the surface. Seeing these different techniques in action, you can likely intuit that the resulting tattoos will have slightly different physical characteristics. You would be correct in that assumption. How each of these tools interacts with the human skin varies depending on the angle and force of penetration and the shape of the tooltip. These differences are visible immediately in terms of overall skin trauma. Here we use the D-Stretch Image Decorrelation plugin to highlight bruising and trauma around each of the designs on Danny's leg immediately after tattooing. We documented the tattoos using a microscope at multiple magnifications for the first 5 days following tattooing, and then at monthly intervals over a period of 6 months. We compared these images to track how long it took for surface wounds to close, for pigments to settle, and to identify physical characteristics of the resulting tattoos. Here you see comparative imagery of the same tattoo created by hand tapping with a single bone point, 24 hours after it was made, after 2 months, and after 6 months. As I already mentioned, there were observable differences. We are not going to dive too deeply into the complete catalog of those differences here, but for example, you see images of healed lines created by hand poking with a deer bone point, a copper awl, and an obsidian flake. Although these are all single point tools wielded using the same method, the copper tool results in cleaner edges than the bone point, while the flat profile shape of the obsidian flake tip resulted in irregular line edges. Alternately, when the same tool type is wielded in a different manner, it yields different results. Here you see a comparison of tattoos incised with the edge of an obsidian flake on the left and hand-poked with a flake tip on the right. Incised lines exhibit clean, strong edges with a few thin oblique trails resulting from changes to the angle of the tool or placement of overlapping cuts. All incised lines exhibit distinctive thinning at one or both ends, created by changes in the depth of the tool over the course of the incision. Along with incised tattoos, subdermal tattooing that you saw a video of earlier resulted in the most distinctive physical traits in our sample. Subdermal tattooing initially resulted in lines of discrete, round to oblong dots surrounding circular punctures. Over the healing process, pigment settled into the areas between the punctures, connecting some adjacent entry and exit points while leaving separation in other areas. It was not possible to create solid, completely filled areas using either incised or subdermal tattooing. By way of comparison, you see here a solid area filled using the copper hand poke tool. Using our data, we can turn to the archaeological record and compare the results to our own ongoing research as well as to published imagery of preserved tattoos. This allows us to make some informed hypotheses regarding the tattooing processes and technologies of specific archaeological cultures. For example, it has been suggested that the body markings of the famous Iron Age mummies from the Altai were created by subdermal methods using eyed gold needles, such as are shown here. We have not been able to obtain microscope images of these remains. Nevertheless, using high-resolution imagery, we may conclude that it is very unlikely the subdermal method was used to create these tattoos, which involve thick, regular bands of packed pigment. Instead, the filled areas of the Scythian tattoos compare favorably with solid fills achieved through hand poking, one example of which you see here. Preserved tattoos have been documented on mummified remains from at least 25 locations in the Pacific deserts of Peru and Chile. Archaeologists working in the region have previously suggested that pre-Columbian cultures in these areas created their tattoos by incision or using subdermal methods. Our direct examinations of tattooed Andean mummies have not revealed any evidence of tattoos consistent with subdermal application in terms of either lines or filled areas. A number of examples we have viewed, and particularly those associated with the Chimu culture, exhibit a technique we refer to as line stacking, in which shapes and solid fills are created by the application of short, adjacent tattooed lines, rather than by being outlined and then filled in. These parallel lines have been mistaken by prior studies as being the result of incision. However, using our data, we can demonstrate that they lack the distinctive end thinning associated with that technique. Instead, it appears to us that these tattoos were created by hand poking, using a combination of single and clustered point tools. Finally, turning to the famous Tyrolean Iceman, whose body is marked with 63 of the oldest preserved tattoos recorded so far. Most published scholarship on these tattoos has concluded that their method of application is unknown. However, there is a popular belief that they were created by incision. This is driven at least in part by their description on the museum webpage, which states that, unlike modern tattoos, they were fine incisions into which pulverized charcoal was rubbed. Using our study data, we can say conclusively that the Iceman's tattoos were not incised. As you can see in comparison with our study images, the Iceman's tattoos do not exhibit the strong edges or tapered ends we found to be distinctive of incised tattoos. For further comparison, this image shows a separate incised tattoo done by Danny using obsidian. It matches the Iceman's marks in terms of size and placement, but has clearly observable structural differences from the original marks. In comparison with our study data, it appears the Iceman was likely tattooed using a single-point hand-poke tool. Available detailed images of the Iceman's tattoos exhibit the same irregular widths, internal stippling, and irregular rounded ends presented on lines in our sample. There are some methodological issues. Although we can look at healed tattoos over a period of months, or even years, we cannot entomb Danny's leg in ice, or leave him in the Andean deserts for several millennia to accurately categorize the taphonomic effects of those situations. There's also the added complication that, while we are observing the pigments at the epidermal level, that layer of skin is partially or entirely degraded on many mummies. Although tattoo ink settles at the dermal-epidermal boundary, how or if that pigment shifts following death and deposition remains unstudied. Despite these concerns, our study provides a first attempt at documenting the physical structure of tattoos created using different methods. We hope this will be useful data for new investigations of preserved tattoos from archaeological and museum settings, as well as for professionals who work to interpret past lifeways for the public. Our thanks to those listed here for their essential support and assistance in our research, and to the meeting organizers for their work. Please feel free to connect with us online via the Instagram feeds shown here. Thank you again for your time.